Welcome to Globe Watch 2021 with me, Charles Obinna-Ed, today from the Indian High Commission here in Yaoundé, Cameroon. Time spent in India had an extraordinary impact on me. Those are the words of Tai Shah, one of the greatest journalists and filmmakers from the United Kingdom, residing in Morocco of Afghan Indian origin. To qualify a country with roughly 1.2 billion citizens in the world and simply qualified to by others as an estate of magic. We are talking about India, a country which of course has proven its worth in many fields, technology and development, ever since it became independent from the British many years ago. Like any other country in the world, India has entered into 2021 with the scars of COVID-19, which today has impacted roughly 100 million people in terms of infections around the world. So, are Indian management wizards on track to keep the country safe from the perks of COVID-19? My guest today on Globe Watch is India's High Commissioner Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary to Cameroon. Rakesh Malhotra, welcome to Globe Watch.
Thank you, Charles, for interviewing me today.
About 10 million people already infected by the coronavirus, with plus 140,000 others dead in India alone. One of your greatest cultural exports, the great soul, Mahatma Gandhi, once said that, quote, "In a gentle way, you can shake the world," end of quote. Did the coronavirus shake India in a gentle way and the rest of the world?
Well, Charles, you are right. Corona has affected India, and you are absolutely right that there are about 10.2 million people who are affected by coronavirus in India, and 147,000 people have died. But if you see that the population of India, which is about 1.3 billion, and if you compare the 1 million figure as how many people have been affected as compared to 1 million people, they are about 538. As compared to world, it is 1453, you know, and if you compare the death rate as per million, it is 15 in India as compared to world of 68. So if you see that India has done comparatively very well to cope with the coronavirus, and there were certain reasons behind it. Prime Minister Modi took the decision to impose the lockdown in early March, and it has been lifted now in 7 phases. Today, people are using the face masks in India. They are using the hand sanitizers.
In a moment, we'll talk about measures which were taken by the government. But let me just go back to the quotation by Mahatma Gandhi. To what level did coronavirus shake India? This is a country of millennia of civilizations. Is there any other event in Indian history, even your departure or separation from Pakistan in 1947, did it shake India the way that coronavirus has shaken India?
Well, I don't think so. There was an event after the partition which has shaken India. But as I was telling you, our response has been very effective, and it has minimized the effect of corona, which otherwise could have been much worse.
Okay, on January 30, 2020, the World Health Organization declared the coronavirus a health emergency of an international outreach, and on that same day, the first case of coronavirus was detected in your country, which has been the most affected sector of the Indian economy?
The Indian economy has been affected by coronavirus, and one of them was tourism, which all over the world has affected India. Of course, the health sector was one of the affected sectors.
You just talked about tourism.
Today you are the full land, you know. Prime Minister Modi, in his address to the nation on Independence Day, has said that, you know, India should be self-reliant. It should not be made in India, but it should be made in for the world. So, you know, and in this coronavirus situation, India has become the pharmacy of the world, producing medicines for the world, you know.
You just said that India has become the pharmacy of the world in this war against coronavirus, but you noticed that the vaccines which have been produced come from Pfizer, United States, Moderna, United States, and the other vaccines that are coming from Oxford. We haven't heard about the pharmaceutical prowess of the Indian health or medical sector. What is wrong?
India is working on the medicine. There are six companies which are working at present in India on this. Three are there in the joint venture with the foreign countries, and three are there indigenous companies. The work is progressing in this regard, and we expect that the medicine will be coming sometime in June or July.
408 million Indian citizens from roughly 83 million families nationwide. How did you succeed to do such a partitioning operation in a country which is in itself a continent?
Well, as I told you, a number of projects were undertaken. Finance Minister announced a number of packages, for financial packages for the SMEs, which included giving the loan to the SMEs, as well as giving the relaxation in repayment of the loans, etc. Government of India changed certain policies in respect of education policy, as well as we changed the policy in the agriculture sector. There was a scheme about Pradhan Mantri Garib Ann Yojana, you know, in which poor people were given rice and wheat, etc.
Well, if we had the map of India straight here, which were the most affected parts of India? Pradesh?
Maharashtra was one of them. You have been there in Mumbai, you know, that was one of them. There were certain other regions, say Madhya Pradesh, etc. and all.
Another question I have to ask you is, how much did the India economy lost or has lost because of COVID-19? Just how much of the GDP has disappeared?
Before the lockdown or before the COVID, we were developing at the rate of 9%, then it has gone to 6% or so. We are expecting that, as per the Economic Intelligence Unit, that we will bounce back in 2021 and will bounce back by the same margin as the GDP was there in 2019. It will come back in 2021.
Just at the beginning of the interview, you said that one of the sectors which was hardly hit was the tourism sector. Each year, about 12 million tourists enter your country. Nearly 7 million of them tour the Taj Mahal, which is one of the greatest wonders of the current century, which is of course found in India, meaning you could not be indifferent to the rest of the world in the face of this cataclysmic sanitary disaster. Can you quantify to me the international response given to COVID-19 by India?
Told you that India became the pharmacy of the world. We supplied medicine to about 85 nations. Out of them were 25 nations from Africa, in which we supplied the medicines. There were about 150 tons of medicines which were supplied at the value of about 10 million.
If you look at the Indian entertainment industry, just cinema in particular, Bollywood, it's roughly 1,800 films produced yearly, and it's contributing a GDP of roughly $2.6 billion to the Indian economy.
What did you do to the entertainment industry, which was equally one of the economic fabrics terribly, terribly affected by COVID-19 in terms of film production, in terms of people gathering to, people could not watch films, go to theater houses? What was the picture in India?
Well, you are right, absolutely, Charles, that the Bollywood industry has been affected very badly with this. Production of movies were almost stopped, you know, and if at all it was being done, or is, it has started now, but if at all it was done, it was done within the four walls of a house or, you know, or a studio, etc. But it has been affected very badly.
I'm sure that even in India, just like in many other parts of the world, the most benefited part of COVID-19 was the digital space. How much money did you make through investments in the digital environment? Because basically, that is where everybody could see each other face to face. So the telecommunication sector should be one of the biggest beneficiaries of COVID-19 in India.
Yes, certainly, Charles, you are right. You know, in the digital journey, you know, we have started E Vidya Bharti. There is a program, and E Arogya Bharti, that's a Government of India program, in which, you know, we are given the telemedicine consultation to the people, the education also is being imparted through E Vidya Bharati program of Government of India. This is available to the foreign nationals also, including Cameroon, and 16 nations have signed the MOU with India on that. I am sure Cameroon will certainly sign it soon so that the people of Cameroon will be benefited from that.
Oh, well, and since you were just talking about the international response of COVID-19, the combined African and Indian populations is estimated at roughly 2.6 billion people. It is a huge market. And out of this, roughly 8 billion people who are in the world today, with an Indian trade volume of about $90 billion investments on the continent. Tell me the main sectors on which this relationship is anchored with Africa.
Absolutely right. You know, India's trade with Africa is about 67 billion, you know, and India has cumulative invested about $54 million dollars, you know, which is given employment to the African people. And it is in the sector of energy, it is in the sector of banking, it is in the sector of mining, etc.
Why those sectors? Because you should be the continent's fourth largest trading partner, behind China, behind the EU, behind the United States. Why those sectors, mining, energy?
These are the, you know, in Africa, the electricity is less, certainly. You have seen it in Cameroon also. So that is one of the sectors. And mining is also, there are many mines in Cameroon also. So these are the sectors which are, it is in textile also, banking sector also, you know. So these are the.
A while ago you said that India has become the pharmacy of the world. One of your government officials said a few years ago, during one of the outings of the India-African summit, Africa is a continent which receives nearly 20% of our pharmaceuticals, that is the Indian pharmaceutical industry. And by comparison, as stated by McKinsey, which is a think tank, China and India each year produce roughly 1.4 billion in population, have as many as 5,000 and 10,000 drug manufacturers, respectively. The sub-Saharan market's value is still relatively small at roughly $14 billion compared with roughly $120 billion in China and $19 billion for India. I can go on. Are you investing for the development of the local pharmaceutical industry on the continent? Because if you can see, this is huge money moving out.
Well, yes, I'm not aware whether you are aware of it or not, but there is a pharmaceutical factory in Dwala which is being operated by Indians. So India is investing in pharmaceutical sector in Cameroon.
Well, one of the kickbacks of either the Indian or the Chinese medical fabric is that the troubles, the physique, the medicines developed in those countries do not actually fit into the health problems of the Africans. The way people face their diseases in India and China is not the same way as we face them in South Africa, we face them in Nigeria. When you do trade deals, especially in the health domain, do you take into consideration the morphology of the people who have to consume those drugs? COVID-19 is a glaring example that medications that work in America, in India, China, necessarily do not work in Africa.
Well, you know, primarily the production in India is for the domestic market, and which for every country it would be, certainly. And probably the manufacturers may take into account the physical needs of the African people in the retired and may dovetail that into the production.
Just how much educational assistance or cooperation exists between India and Africa today? The India-African Summit 2020 was supposed to hold, but COVID-19 completely kept it out of the agenda. In terms of education, do you exchange with students?
Yes, certainly. We encourage students going from Cameroon to India. Under the Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation, we are given about 32 slots for Cameroonian students. Last year, about 22 slots were utilized. And if Cameroon is able to utilize these 32 slots, we will certainly look into increasing these slots also. But there are many private universities in India where the Cameroonian students can go and learn from India. There could be some cooperation between the universities in India and the universities in Cameroon.
Let's talk the place of India in the world today. 12 of the world's most performing, largest, biggest companies are managed by Indians. Arvind Krisha is the CEO of IBM International Business Machines. He's of Indian origin. Sundar Pichai, the CEO of Google and Alphabet, the biggest in the search engine world, is of Indian origin. Satya Nadella, the CEO of Microsoft, is of Indian origin. Santanu Narayan, the CEO of Adobe, one of the biggest editing software producing companies in the world, is of Indian origin. Ajaypal Singh Bangal, CEO of MasterCard, is of Indian origin. Rajeshuri, the CEO of Nokia, one of the greatest mobile telephone producing companies in the world, is of Indian origin. And the list can go on. Now you add the Vice President of the United States of America, Kamala Harris, is of Indian origin. If somebody tells you that India runs the world, how do you respond?
Well, it's absolutely a proud moment for us. Yeah, you are right. You know, in the initial stages of our independence, we invested in education of the people. You know, IITs and IIMs in India, they are the world-class education centers, and the result is that you know people are getting into the education and holding the high positions all over the world.
I'm putting the question to you because one of the fewest countries the outgoing U.S. administration ever stepped legs into, I'm talking about Donald Trump, was India, had an excellent relation with Prime Minister Narendra Modi. How do you see the U.S. India relations in the era of Biden, when one of the top executives in that administration is of Indian descent. I saw all the prayers made by the magic, the gods of India, for Biden to win so that Kamala Harris can be vice president, a potential president in the United States.
Well, you know, India and U.S. both are democratic countries.
Maybe I should just remind my audience that India is the world's largest electoral democracy.
Yes, and U.S. too is the democratic countries. In democracy, the governments come and go, you know, and the relationship hinges on the institutional arrangements between the two countries. I'm not aware whether you are aware of or not. Prime Minister Modi got the award of Legion of Merit from President Trump. The similar award was given to the Prime Minister of Japan as well as the Prime Minister of Australia. The relationship between the two leaders were excellent. But as soon as the elections were results were declared, Prime Minister called the President elect, and they had a very nice telephonic conversation in which they decided to carry forward the strategic relations between the two countries forward, you know. So with the change of the government in U.S., I don't think there is going to be any effect on India's relations with U.S.
One of the last question: you are the first Indian High Commission and Cameroon resident in Yaoundé. How far India and Cameroon got with your relations?
Well, you know, relations between the two countries has been excellent. You know, President Paul Biya went to India in 1983. Your Prime Minister went to India in 2013. And Foreign Minister Bela Bela went to India in 2015 for the India-Africa Foreign Summit. The trade between the two countries is about 903 million out of that 670 million is from Cameroon to India and about 230 million from India to Cameroon. So trade of balance of trade is in favor of Cameroon, for which we need to do something. Similarly, there is a lot of potential to increase the trade between the two countries. And for that, probably the Commerce Minister, I suppose, should lead a delegation to India, because I think the information depth is too much between the two countries. You know, unless the businessmen go to India, they will not be able to know what India has to offer on that. Similarly, for the investment, I suppose there is a scheme in which India offers soft loans to foreign countries. Cameroon could avail the benefit of that so that there could be some investment from India. And there are already two projects which are going on. One project is going on for the transmission line, and the other project is Kasava project, etc. But there could be number of projects could be undertaken through the line of credit between India and Cameroon.
Finally, when you look at the global environment today as a diplomat, what do you think is the world's greatest challenge that each time you go on bed, you say that it is the greatest threat to humanity?
Well, you know, the foreign relations between all the countries should be peaceful, and we should be able to work within our differences, whatever is there between the two countries, and there should be peace for all the countries in this world.
The Indian High Commissioner to Cameroon, Sri Rakesh Malhotra, thank you very much indeed for being guest on Blue Watch, and this was your Pioneer One-on-One television interview with the Cameroonian media.
Thank you, Charles, for this opportunity to speak to the Cameroonian audience. I would like to wish them a very happy New Year.
You are welcome.